Praise the Lord. I don't know if this is working or not, is it? Maybe need to be turned on.
Well, we got a red light on back here.
No, it's the other box.
Oh, that's all right. It ain't.
Praise the Lord.
Come on. Well,
help
get everything hooked up,
right? There it is. Glory, hallelujah. God is good, isn't he?
All the time.
Amen. Got a case of my book is being mailed to a Bible college in India. They want books, and they teach, you know, it's a Bible college. So, that's good. I'm going to praise the Lord for that. And they're being sent to the case of them to South Africa. So I'm excited about that and just reach the world. Amen.
Amen.
And that's great. And I have this past week, I've really been writing. And I wrote my second book is finished and it's edited. So all it has to do is the cover and it's done. And so that's the Lord there. It's about the Holy Spirit and fire. And a real biblical study on the baptism and biblically. And it has this 50% scripture in it. So, and I wanted to, that's a subject, you want a lot of scripture in that. And just talk about, the real baptism and kind of clearing up the misconceptions about it and different things. So I'm excited about that. We got a prayer request here from India. I know it was an email was saying that they had a all night prayer last night. Well, that when they sent it, I guess it's Friday night, they had an all-night prayer. And they prayed for us, me, my family, and this church. And they're praying for to have an India trip. And they wanted us to pray for them. My bishop, Dr. Sam, as he goes by Sam, but his full name's, I don't know how you pronounce it, Sam Babu or something like that, but they had an all-night prayer and they prayed for us, so that's good, isn't it?
Amen.
Well, we need it, and I wanted to praise the Lord about that, and just open up in prayer. Lord, I ask you to move tonight. Holy Spirit, you're welcome in this place. God, I ask you to pour your spirit out in a powerful way and do great things. I ask you, God, to just touch this person here and their congregation, his congregation, Lord, in the name of Jesus. And touch that Bible college in India,
yes,
Lord, and that group in South Africa,
yes,
Lord, and that group in Liberia, Lord, and the other group in India that we send to regularly. Bless them, Lord, in the name of Jesus, and touch them in a powerful way. God, to send revival to India, Lord, and to shake a country, Lord, for you, God, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Glory. Hallelujah. I was watching some of the things about the earlier vineyard. I don't know if you heard about the vineyard. You ever knew about the vineyard movement? John Wimber. And I was watching that, and they got started in pretty much the Jesus movement, Jesus people movement, which is Calvary Chapel was the main part of that movement. Well, the man that started Calvary Chapel, I can't think of his name right now. Was it Chuck Swindoll? I can't remember his name. He was on TV. He's passed away here recently, but he was on TV. You know, his church was, he was on TV for years. But it was a powerful movement that it got started, and it's kind of got started with just a handful of people. And the Vineyard movement, they had their, the denomination is still going, but it's not as big as it, not as notable as it was. But see, that's what the Toronto blessing was, the Vineyard Church, when it started. And John Wimber really helped pioneer about prayer for healing. He really helped pioneer to get it out to everybody, not just a certain few. He was the one that really pioneered that, of everybody having that anointing, that if you're born again, that you can pray for healing. And he pioneered teachings on that. That's really was John Wimber's legacy, was that. And I was just watching, that was interesting, and I was watching how they got started with that. Was they had a lot of people coming, and of course the hippie generation in that time, and a lot of the, we call hippies, was part of the movement, and a lot of people was coming, and they didn't want it to be like these certain superstars, could only people that could pray for healing and had saw healing regularly. And they said it should be for everybody. Everybody that's born again should be able to pray for healing. So they started it that way. And he said he prayed for 1,000 people before anyone got healed. I thought that was interesting. But I like history and how different movements begin. And I encourage you, if you do some research on that, that'll change you. And that had started in California. I actually thought it started in Britain, but it was started in California.
It actually got 1,500 affiliated churches in the group now.
1,500 now around the world. Of course, there would be no Pensacola revival if it wasn't for the Vineyard. And there'd be no revival around the world right now if it wasn't for the Vineyard. Because I know that might sound a bold statement, but of course the Toronto church was a Vineyard church, and that's where revival hit, and it spread from there to Brownsville and other places. So if it wasn't for John Wimber, you know, a lot of people wouldn't be born again right now. And so that's something to think about. You don't, you give honor where honor's due. You honor people, and I believe in honoring people. If you honor them, it says you receive a prophet in the name of a prophet, you shall receive a prophet's reward. That's a Bible verse. So I believe if you honor someone and recognize that gift on them, you can in turn pull on that gift and, you know, learn from it. Because you can't learn from someone if you don't honor them. You got to honor them. You know, you don't worship them, but you can honor them, honor their gift. You know what I mean? And that's something that I like history, so I could talk about history and stuff all night. I like history in the church and history in general. I always have, and I just think it's great to learn, because you learn from their mistakes. Towards later on in his life, he got kind of, believe it or not, the stuff he pioneered, he didn't like towards later on in his life, and he kind of had huge arguments that it caused great schisms with some people that God was really using, and he kind of pushed them away, and his wife kind of made up with the people and realized that he was wrong. And so you can learn from that, you know. And I love history, so let me go into praise and worship, because I could talk about history all night. And I just encourage you to go in John Wimber, watch some of his things in the Vineyard. It's just a pretty good history there. And they're not as notable as it was. I know and Kansas City used to be. They started out a Vineyard, I think. Sean Bowles, he was a Vineyard. And a lot of them was. More people than you think. He looked like who was that singer? Had that beard. He looked like that singer, kind of like that Bob Donahue.
ZZ Top.
No.
There's a whole bunch of them guys with beards.
Country type pop singer.
Yeah, they sang an evangelist over here. was a group, what, there was a group of them?
No, this man was a real famous secular guy, but he looks like him, or like Donahue, kind of like a member of Donahue on TV.
Yeah.
And the singer looked like him, I can't think of his name. He sung a song with Dolly Parton once. That's who he looked like.
I know who you're talking about, but I can't think of his name,
but that's who he looked like. So, but God is good.
Amen.
Start this.
Thank you.
Praise you, Jesus.
Oh,
praise you, King.
His name is Officer Russell for the Oldham County Police Department. He's coming back by 7 o'clock to witness me doing this.
Okay.
Okay, that's good.
And it's what it's for. This is gonna be my second go-around of being baptized. But I'm doing it in the name of God and the name of heaven.
Amen.
And I'm redoing my life through this.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
My most thing I'm asking for the most is God to forgive me for all the smoking I have done, the drugs I've done in the past life, and everything I've done in my past.
Mm. Amen.
Amen.
Lord, I ask you to touch him, Lord, in the name of Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
Ask you to touch him in a powerful way.
Yes.
And this healing, we speak a healing in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
In his back and body, in the name of Jesus. Lord, I ask you to just fall on him, God, in a powerful way, and just heal him and change his life, Lord, in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus. More, Lord. Touch him, Lord. More, Lord. Touch him, Lord, in a powerful way. More, Lord. Glory, hallelujah. More, Lord. Glory, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Touch him, Lord, in a powerful way. Touch him, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Glory, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
I've had a reoccurring a dream that the Lord brought to me to share tonight. A little bit of that, because I think it'll touch someone. In this dream, I was going from my house, driving to the road up to uptown, but the road was gone. It was like driving to a rough creek that you couldn't hardly drive, and it was like a. Really just. Almost like you needed a four-wheel drive vehicle, and I was driving in a car. I don't know whose car it was. Seemed like it wasn't the ones I own right now, but it was really rough, and the road was pretty much gone. It was just rocks and mud and everywhere.
Wasn't a Jeep.
And it was I wasn't driving in the Jeep, but I needed to, and it was awful. And a lot of people was having trouble and stuff. And I've had this dream several times lately here recently, and. What comes to my mind is something that should be an easy trip. It should be easy, and it should be not hard at all. It ends up being difficult. And you barely make it, and it ends up being real hard. And it's stuff that's not of your own design. It's stuff that obstacles you've run into that makes it hard. It's not something that you've done yourself. It's things that you have to travel across. And it does seem like that way with me, how to deal. And when it got into ministry, it should be easy. But it was an obstacle course, and it's hard. And it's always something to throw it in your path that you got to deal with. And you should have this easy, simple, quick course, and it's real hard. And some people in their lives, you might be going through that tonight or here recently, that it feels like where it should be easy and a simple path, and there should be things that where you have it lined out and then said, well, okay, this is going to be easy. I finally got it lined out. This is going to be quick. It's going to be easy. And it ends up being 3-4 times the time, ends up being a lot of issues and a lot of trouble. And you're having a hard time, and it just makes it a hard journey. And Peter, Jesus told Peter, it was a matter of fact conversation. He said, the devil wishes to sift you like wheat. The devil wishes to destroy you.
Mm-hmm.
But Jesus said, but I prayed for you.
Amen.
That was an actual conversation in the Bible. It said, but I have prayed for you. Now you think about that. The devil wishes to come against you, destroy you. He wishes that. Because he don't got you. He wishes that. He wishes to take your life out. He wishes to cause harm to you. He wishes to pollute everything you do. He wishes to destroy the work of your hands. But Jesus said, but I have prayed for you.
Amen.
But I have prayed. There's a but. For God will bless the work of your hands. He blessed the fruit of your labor. Everything that you touch shall prosper. But the devil wishes the opposite.
That's right.
Jesus said the devil comes to kill, to steal, and to destroy. But Jesus came that you'd have life and have it more abundantly.
Amen.
See, that's a complete contrast of the two. That's a contrast of the two right there. Death or life?
Make a choice.
But now here's the thing. We falsely teach sometimes that when you choose life, that it's going to be easy.
Choose death, it's going to be wrong.
Yeah. The death, it'll be wrong. It'll be broad path, but it'll be wrong.
I heard the same chapter in the church I attended to in Little Rock, Arkansas, called Lifeline Baptist.
Oh, wow. And we need to think about that. Life, it's going to be hard. Anything is good, it's going to be hard. You ever heard that saying?
Yes, sir.
But it's there's another verse that's in the Psalms. It says, there's a verse in the Psalms that talks about the wicked will go through one thing, and that'll be the end of them. Because, you know, David's kind of wondering. David was always kind of wondering. I guess, you know, he went through a lot of things, David did. His son tried to overthrow him. And, you know, he did overthrow him, actually. And that would be a pretty big hit to your son, you know. And one of his sons raped one of his daughters, you know. That'd be a big hit too. And they got mad at David once, and they thought it was a slap to his supporters, slap in their face, because he wouldn't punish his son. And they thought it was a slap in their face. They considered an insult because of what they did. They thought he should be punished. He went through a lot of like this and this and this, and you know, when his wife made fun of him because he was praising the Lord, one of his wives, and you know, just a lot of things he went through. And you know, and as soon as he was and kind of get you a picture of David's life, you know, soon as, well, pretty close to, it was a little while afterwards, but he was Samuel anointed him king and anointed him. And when he come to his brother's house, so even his dad looked over him at that time. Now you think about that, all the stuff he went through. His dad even looked over him. Samuel had to ask for him. But that was the one that the Lord picked. And he was always the one that kind of people wanted to take advantage of him, look over him. You know, Saul turned on him, wanted to kill him, tried to kill him, went out living in the caves, him, a group of his faithful people that got around. They were so faithful to him that they forsook everything and followed him. Kind of picture what we should do for Jesus.
Yeah. Amen.
But they forsook everything and live in caves. I mean, not just one cave. They've had to go a lot of different places. They didn't have a home.
Nope.
And he had a pretty difficult life. So you would think, and he had to call of God to be a king, and it was anointed. You'd think, well, you picture, man, this guy's got it made. But you don't know what goes on behind the scenes. You don't know what he went through. People might see him sitting on that throne, but they don't know what it took to get there. And his son, Solomon, succeeded him. And all that stuff that Solomon had, and they don't know what it took, the bloodshed and the toil and the hurt that it took to get to that.
That rocky road you seen.
Yeah. Don't know what it took behind the scenes, where it should be easy, but it's not. So keeping that in mind, there's a psalm that said, talks about, and you wonder, well, why is it that I go through so many things? It's just like it's one thing after another. I think it almost every week, probably daily, sometimes. So just to be honest, I'll tell you, I think that. You, no one else does. I'll tell you, I think that. I think every week, I want to get out of ministry. How easy it would be not being in the ministry. You just go to work, you go home, you don't have to worry about that stuff. You know?
It won't be that way either there.
Chris Ballard, he always says that stuff, you know, and others, they say that, oh, I just think of how easy it is if you get out of ministry. And he said, that's the people that God has called, the people. They said, if you don't think that, you might. Anyway, David, I think of the Psalms as more of a journal of his thoughts. The ones he wrote as his thoughts and his journal, his personal prayers.
Amen.
And his personal thoughts. Pretty honest. And I can hear him thinking, well, why is it this person here, nothing seems to go wrong? His family's okay. Nothing seems to happen. And this guy's wicked. But look at him. Probably, you know, thinking about a neighboring kingdom or something. Look at his family. His kids love him. They don't do that stuff that my kids do. They do to me. Look, everything he's... Nothing happens to him. But look at me, all the stuff I got. Look at this. All the stuff I went through. And that's why he couldn't build the temples, because he's had blood on his hands.
Bad choices.
So he's thinking that. But then, you know, but the light come on his head, on him. It's like the Holy Spirit. I believe David was baptized in the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Just people in the Old Testament that was baptized in the Holy Spirit. That's in the book I wrote. It talks about that. People think it's not, but there is.
Oh, yeah.
It says that it was. There is some people that just wasn't a mass. But the difference between, how am I going to get into that sermon? There's a difference. But I believe he was. And I know the Holy Spirit kind of touched him, and he said, you know, you watch them when they go through one thing. It might seem good. I mean, they might seem like they have a perfect life, but watch them when they go through one thing. It'll be the last thing they go through to destroy them. One thing. He said, all the things that you went through, and you're still alive. You're still here. It says, many of the afflictions of the righteous, but he will deliver them out of them all. And I wasn't planning on preaching that, but I just felt like the Holy Spirit was touching me about talking about that a little, because sometimes it's good to hear that sermon. You know, it's just kind of good to get a reminder of that. But it does say that. And we need to think about those things and keep that in mind. And all the times that you got to go through rough times, you know, I go through that. You know, you can be the nicest in the world to some, you know, and you end up getting in trouble. You know, or just something, you did something wrong. No matter how good you did it, it's your fault. Anybody know what I'm talking about?
Yep.
David went through that many a times. Some of it was his fault, and some of it wasn't. When it comes to Saul's case, it definitely wasn't his fault. And this is the way it happens. The Lord uses that to, you know, he makes you have more patience. That's what the verse says in the Bible. And it makes you have more patience. And I can tell you that it does make you have more patience. And I just wanted to speak on that. You make sure he's got that on there right. His mic.
Looks good to me.
We tried that out last week and it worked pretty good. Had a little squeal just last week.
That was your mic that you got there, though, doing that.
Halfway through your sermon, possibly do the baptism and come back.
He said he'd be back at 7.
That's right. On. Should be.
Is it on? Can you hear anything? No.
Should be on.
Test.
Should be on. Oh,
testing.
I hear something.
Yeah,
it's on.
Yeah,
it's going to get close enough, probably.
Yeah,
that all sad.
How about now?
How's that?
That's good.
That's better. First thing I thought about was Rocky Road, that those are your character builders. And if you don't build the characters, you might as well get out of the ministry.
Yeah.
That would be no fun.
Yeah.
Joseph had a Rocky.
Anyway, well, it's good to be back. I know it's been about 4 weeks.
Yeah.
Yeah, Christmas time, and health and weather, just sometimes just.
Yeah.
Keeps you humble, a little more humble than you want to be, I guess.
Yeah.
What I had planned a few weeks back was a subject matter that a lot of us struggle with, and that's prayer. And this might have been a good thing for him to listen to, but that's okay. I can give him a copy of this. You can do that too. Prayer is something I've always struggled with, and I still struggle with it, you know. What should I say? How close should I, you know? Should we glorify God? That's all we do. Should we talk to him like a brother or sister or mom or dad? Or, you know, how should we really pray? It's, for a lot of people, it's a struggle. It is. How should I pray at church? How should I pray at my bedside? You know, there's a lot of unanswered questions. Hopefully I've got some scriptures that will help us with that. But this is also part of my second book. This is going to be called Living by the Power of Prayer. How truly prepared are you honestly to deal with the rest of your life? What I mean is, what do you have as a deterrent to the negative issues that will most assuredly pop up at a moment's notice? Those rocky roads. Or better yet, what do you have to propel you forth towards a more fulfilling life? Do you truly have what it takes to make things happen to thwart off evil, or to better your life circumstances on your own? Too many times in our lives, we convince ourselves that I got this, I can make it happen, it's just a minor inconvenience, I get the money somehow to pay that bill. Oh, There is a payday loan office, and that's happened in our family. There's a payday loan office, let's go see what they can do for me. Dangerous stuff.
Oh, yeah.
And let me stop there, you know, at that payday loan office and get an advance on my next paycheck. The interest rate's not too bad, about 450%. Boy, how dangerous it is to follow our own pride in our decision-making of life. We're truly our own worst enemy when it comes to our own best interest. Or at least, that is the way Satan would have it, to live the sin of pride. That's one of the top sins, I do believe, right? Pride.
Amen.
So what is the answer? What are we missing since life, it seems, isn't getting any better? As you say, it's getting tougher by the moment. The main ingredient to any life of abundance and of overflow blessings is to have a life that includes everyday prayer, every hour prayer, minute by minute praying. Oh, I know there are some secularists out there saying that they are living the way they want to live. They are happy with what they are in control of. Maybe they are, but that is just an existence. But they truly are not living a happy life. Just put them side by side with a true prayer warrior and let them debate the issue and see who comes out on top. Remember this, to have no prayer in your life means that you will never have power over your life and no power over the world which seeks to destroy you. Consider this from Mark 9. There are spiritual forces that Jesus says are very hard to overcome. His disciples ask, why could we not cast it out? Jesus answered, insufficient prayer. Mark 9:29, this kind cannot be driven out by anything but prayer. Mark 14:38, watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation. One thing to note here is that the disciples did pray over the boy, but had they truly lived their lives in prayer, by not living it, they truly had no power through prayer, and without having persistent, fervent prayer, we have no offense, no power. And that is worth repeating. By not living it, they truly had no power through prayer, and without having persistent, fervent prayer, we have no offense or no power. And that is just the truth.
Yeah.
Why do you think so many churches become divided and never grow? Oh, the sin of prayerlessness. Prayer is as vital to the life of the Holy Spirit as breathing is to sustaining the life of the body. Prayerlessness is a sin.
Amen.
1 Samuel 12, 23-24. Moreover, as for me, God forbid that I should sin against the Lord in ceasing to pray for you, but I will teach you the good and the right way. Only fear the Lord and serve him in truth with all your heart. For consider how great things he hath done for you. Consider how great things hath done for you. There is nothing better, I feel, than praising God more for the blessings he has already done for you. He allowed you to wake up today, didn't he? Satan did not wake you up. He would rather have you dead in hell. I'll go ahead and
do
baptism now.
It doesn't matter. We can do it now, or if you want to wait, or...
He's ready to go now, I think.
Yeah, I'm ready to do it.
So he called me to be a witness for him.
That's right.
Yeah. And we'll be back and finish that.
My palms ease.
Yeah.
This is our first baptism for Revival Is Here Church. Can't get you sound, but at least you're going to get to see the video. need, hallelujah. Amen. First baptism. Praise God.
Is it up?
Yeah. We're up and running.
Well, congratulations, Pastor Chad Chan. This is his first baptism.
Uh-huh.
I'll reread the 1 Samuel 12, 23 through 24. Moreover, as for me, God forbid that I should sin against the Lord in ceasing to pray for you, but I will teach you the good and the right way. Only fear the Lord and serve him in truth with all your heart. Consider how great things he hath done for you. And consider how great things hath done for you. There is nothing better, I feel, than praising God more for the blessings he has already done for you. He allowed you to wake up today, right?
Amen.
Satan did not wake you up. He would rather have you dead in hell.
That's right.
Since he knows we can't control us. Luke 18:1, and he spake a parable unto them to this end, that men ought always to pray and not to faint. Always to pray no matter what. Pray as your life depends on it, for it truly does. 1 Thessalonians 5:17 through 28. Pray without ceasing, and everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Quench not the spirit, despise not prophecies. Prove all things, hold fast that which is good, abstain from all appearance of evil, and the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray, God, your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. Brethren, pray for us. Greet all the brethren with an holy kiss. I charge you by the Lord that this epistle be read unto all the holy brethren. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen. For all these, for all things through prayer and supplication, for all things, I see this as God's requirement for our lives. Almost, I would see as a commandment. Ephesians 6:18 through 19. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. And for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. Open our mouths boldly.
Amen.
Amen.
Not meekly, not with uncertainty, but boldness.
Amen.
Excuse me. James 4:17. Therefore, to him that knoweth to do good, and doeth it not, to him it is sin. God lays out the plans for your life, including a fervent prayer life, and not to follow through enjoy help. Romans 14, 22 through 23. Hast thou faith? Have it to thyself before God. Happy is he that condemneth not himself, and that bring which he alloweth. And he that doubteth is damned if he eat, because he eateth not of the faith, for whatsoever is not of faith is sin. Excuse me, getting over a little bronchitis. To have faith is only possible through a fervent, habitual prayer life, which is a direct 911 prayer line phone, but a 333 prayer line from Jeremiah 33:3. Call unto me, and I will answer thee, and shew thee great and mighty things which thou knowest not. Hebrews 11:6. But without faith it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Faith and must believe are the key words in the scripture. You must believe that having faith in something unseen will have a profound positive effect on you and your loved ones' lives. And most importantly, claiming what is rightfully yours as a child of God. You got to claim it.
Amen.
Hebrews 22, 1 through 2. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, unto for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Jesus Christ, the author and finisher of our faith, who died a grueling death for us to receive a clean, sinless bill of health. How could you ever think of turning away from him by not living a prayerful life? Romans 8, 26. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Jesus Christ, Christ's gift to us to carry on where he left off after leaving this earth, our personal Holy Spirit to lead us into salvation. If we will be just quiet enough to listen deep in our hearts and souls, for he will lead us down the right prayerful path.
Amen.
Matthew 6, 9 through 13, Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Here's your prayer right there, buddy.
You make it, sir.
All right.
And I'll take it.
There you go.
Take it right here.
If there weren't ever a starter prayer for beginners, as well as a prayer to be repeated even by the best of prayer warriors, this scripture is truly it. Regardless of how well-versed you are in prayer, if not already, burn this scripture to memory and quote it each and every day. This verse surely covers everything that a prayer should cover: praising our one true God, bringing to us a fruitful harvest, forgiveness to all who have done us wrong, and forgiveness for what we have done wrong, and to keep us from ever backsliding again. Can I get a big amen and hallelujah?
Amen.
Come on.
Amen.
Come on.
Amen.
Matthew 26:41. Watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak.
Yep.
A perfect verse to remind us daily of how our flesh can make us backslide back into the old ways. A great reminder of casting away the old demons from our past to never return again. Luke 22:40. And when he was at the place, he said unto them, pray that ye enter not into temptation. Jesus' general reminder to his beloved disciples not to let the flesh overshadow their dedication to their Lord and Savior. Remember these very critical issues of sin because of the lack of prayer. 1. When we do not pray, we sin against God. Notice in 1 Samuel 12:23, against the Lord. Additional reference scriptures, Psalms 51:4. Against thee, thee only, have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest, and be clear when thou judgest. Luke 15:21, and the Son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven, and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Number two, when we do not pray, we sin against others. Notice in 1 Samuel 23, for you, we rob someone else's healings. We rob others of knowing a better life with Christ. Never really looked at it that way, but it's pretty interesting. Number three, when we do not pray, we sin against ourselves. We rob ourselves of the blessings that come into our hearts and lives. Without our prayers, there will be no blessings poured out upon us. Prayer is the only power on earth that has any chance to move the heavens. That's it.
Amen.
It's the only power on earth. For there is great power in the praying of faith. When praying, remember that we are requesting God's presence. Confidence and assurance will be built mightily through the manifestation of praying. Lack of faith in how it can destroy. I think I told you guys a little bit the funeral we went to Steve. I did Steve's funeral. And I just stood there and just watched the family. I didn't really know if I really wanted to do it, because there was such a lack of faith. If it wasn't for me getting to Steve that day in the hospital, he would have gone to hell. And that was the only thing that really I think God had me to do with Steve, more so than do the funeral for him, was to make sure he repeated the sinner's prayer. And hallelujah. I got to him, and his soul, he is in heaven. I'm confident of that. And
hallelujah.
God told me
thank
he went
you,
to
Lord.
Heaven.
Amen.
And that has nothing to do with me, but what I'm saying there is that lack of prayer can kill your relatives, can kill your kids, can kill your aunts, your uncles. The lack of belief, the unbelief can destroy families. And it,
that's it.
I saw it firsthand.
Amen.
And now I'm working on his wife to get her to understand that. But it's tough. It's without prayer and without belief, there's no chance for a decent life. There isn't. Mm. James 5:13-20, is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Is any merry? Let him sing psalms. Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord, and the prayer of faith shall save his sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. And if he have committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. Confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that ye may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Elias was a man subject to like passions as we are, and he prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruit. Brethren, if any of you do err from the truth, and one converteth him, let him know that he which converteth the sinner from the error of his way shall have a soul from death, and shall hide a multitude of sins. We see in verse 13, let him pray when you are in trouble. In verse 14, let them pray when you are sick. In verse 16, and pray for one another. In verse 17, and he prayed. In verse 18, and he prayed again. Praying at all times. Verse 16, I feel, is one of the most important of all. The commandments state to love your neighbor, treat others as you would want to be treated, so why not include your neighbors and friends in those prayers, as well as our government officials, teachers, your church.
Amen.
Pray for the whole gamut.
Yep.
That should be a daily ritual. There is one aspect of praying that could be the most important of all, and that is the corporate prayer. And as we know, when one prays, 1,000 evil spirits flee. Where two or more pray, 10,000 will flee. Where three pray, 100,000 evil spirits will flee, so on and so forth. So you see, just a few together can and will cast out a hell of a lot of demons, for lack of better words. Remember one thing, though, when dealing in this type of spiritual warfare, there better not be any reservations and or unbelief in any part of your spiritual armor, or it could be deadly. One thing I want to reiterate here, though, is that I am in no way saying that corporate praying is more important than individual one-on-one praying. But believe you me, there is power in numbers.
Amen.
Look at the apostles. They did very little together until they came into agreement through corporate prayer. Here are a handful of scriptures that will support the power of the church when it comes together in corporate prayer. Acts 6:2-6. And the 12 called the multitude of the disciples unto them and said, it is not reason that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. Wherefore, brethren, look ye out among you 7 men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. And the saying pleased the whole multitude, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Ghost, and Philip, and Prochorus, and Nicanor, and Timon, and Permanus, and Nicholas, a proselyte of Antioch, whom they set before the apostles, and when they had prayed, they laid their hands on them. Revelations 8:1-5. And when he had opened the 7th seal, there was silence in heaven about the space of 30 minutes. And I saw the 7 angels which stood before God, and to them were given 7 trumpets. And another angel came and stood at the altar, having a golden censer, and there was given unto him much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of all saints upon the golden altar which was before the throne. And the smoke of the incense, which came with the prayers of the saints, ascended up before God out of the angel's hand. And the angel took the censer and filled it with fire of the altar and cast it into the earth. And there were voices and thunderings and lightnings and an earthquake. There is proof positive that the prayers of this world will move the heavens.
Amen.
Or the prayers of the saints, say, of the world. Acts 12:1-6. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them a cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterance. And there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men, out of every nation under heaven. Now when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together and were confounded, because that every man heard them speak in his own language.
Praise the Lord.
Definition of prayer. An outpouring of the soul to God in the name of Christ and through the strength of the Holy Spirit for those things He would have us receive. There are 3 types of prayers. There's proactive, take authority with and in power, being proactive. There's preventative, which I think most of us would probably pray more than anything else, praying against something before it starts.
Amen.
Poor health, poor finances, staying above your issues and not from below. How many times do we complain about our illness instead of praying over them?
Yeah.
I think most of us can say what we do before we realize what we did wrong. And there's prophetic, what we want to see happen, the blessings we desire as long as they fall in line with what God truly wants for us. Be careful of what you pray for.
Amen.
You know, if your chances of your prayers being answered will fall in line with what God, you can ask God for anything. But if he doesn't feel it's going to turn around and bless him, or you're going to turn around and use it for blessing him and blessing others, then you may just not get it. So you may want to think about what you're praying for. Romans 10:9, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thy heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Matthew 21:22, and all things whatsoever ye shall ask in prayer, believing, ye shall receive. Mark 11:23, for verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. In closing, here is the Daniel plan for our lives. I like that, the Daniel plan.
Mm-hmm.
He got a good plan for us. He did it right. Daniel 6, 1 through 11. It pleased Darius to set over the kingdom on 120 princes, which should be over the whole kingdom, and over these three presidents, of whom Daniel was first, that the princes might give accounts unto them, and the king should have no damage. And this Daniel was preferred above the presidents and the princes, because an excellent spirit was in him, and the king thought to set him over the whole realm. Then the presidents and princes sought to find occasion against Daniel concerning the kingdom, but they could find none occasion or fault. For as much as he was faithful, neither was there any error or fault found in him.
Right.
Then said these men, we shall not find any occasion against this Daniel, except we find it against him concerning the law of his God. Then these presidents and princes assembled together to the king and said thus unto him, King Darius, live forever. All the presidents of the kingdom, the governors and the princes, the counselors and the captains have consulted together to establish a royal statute and to make a firm decree that to whoever shall ask a petition of any god or man for 30 days, save of thee, O king, he shall be cast into the den of lions. Now, O king, establish the decree and sign the writing that it be not changed according to the law of the Medes and Persians, which altereth not. Wherefore, King Darius signed the writing and decree. Now when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went into his house, and his windows being open in his chamber towards Jerusalem, he kneeled upon his knees three times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God, as he did it aforetime. Then these men assembled and found Daniel praying and making supplication before his God. How many of us would have had the faith in what he was truly facing in these days of time, mm-hmm, to just still give all the glory to God? Mm-hmm. That's tough.
Yep.
That's why I think this is quite important, that, you know, you praise him when you're feeling great, you praise him when you're feeling bad. Love on him, talk to him like his child, you know. Mm. Asking him for permission for everything. He loves that. And sing to him.
Amen.
Doesn't matter what your voice sounds like mine, he loves it. To him it sounds like Celine Dion.
Maybe anyway. Better.
Yeah. So today, why not start either developing a great prayer plan as Daniel had in the midst of his desperate trials? Even though he was a mighty man of God, the world still found a way of hating him and persecuting him. And if you already feel you have a good prayer life, then get it to the next level of greatness as David had. And it's not, this life is going to get worse, harder and harder up until the rapture. I mean, I don't know what you feel. Obviously, the year of Jubilee is upon us. I'm seeing that maybe the next 7 years coming upon. This is my gut feeling that we're going to be in 7 years of goodness. So grab a hold of it. Get everything out of it you can for the glory of God, and live for him and keep pressing forward for him and glorifying him. And I think these next 7 years are going to be pretty phenomenal for all of us. That's just my gut feeling. What do you think, Shane?
Yeah, I think so.
I think it is. So grab a hold of it. Just get your prayer life where it needs to be. Doesn't have to be difficult. It can be simple. Just talk to him like you're his child. You know, just talk to him one on one. That's all I've got.
You like that?
Yeah.
Good word.
I mean,
yes, yeah, good word.
Can, praise
you
God.
You can get up and go around. And, you know,
yeah.
You're not tied to the.
Yeah, we got a good deal on that too, so I couldn't pass that up. That's a good word.
And, amen.
We had a good, did have to have an interruption, but it was a good interruption to have a, I don't call it interruption, but
we baptized someone, and that was really good. My first baptism. I learned next time I'm going to have someone help me do it. I had a hard time. And it was good, though, and I think he got healed because I asked him how his back was, and he said it was good.
Hallelujah.
So that would be a good thing. So I love that, and it's about reaching people, and that blessed me. Might have another one next week, so I gave her one last week. So either Greg and some, you know, both of y'all just bring a change of clothes and with you too next week, and I bring some, and everybody bring some kind of change of clothes so Casey needs some help baptizing.
Come prepared, huh?
Come prepared. And that's good that we have an area that we don't have to fill it up. That's good. And had some police officers witness it, and it was a good time. Good time. And like I told him, I said, well, there's a big discussion on how you should baptize. I personally was raised to do it, and it was, and Jesus said to do it in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and you dunk them. So I did it in authority in the name of Jesus. I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I said, so that way it's got, you got you covered either way. He said, that sounds good.
Amen.
He got you covered either way. But I'm excited that we, just a powerful thing. And good week. Book should be delivered over there in southern, in India, to Bible College, and probably in South Africa too. And so I'm excited about that. I just think of these people in the Bible College are reading that and just reaching that area in India, and that just blesses me. And I'm excited about that. Tithes and offerings time. If you need an envelope, this one here. If you need an envelope. Or, Lord, bless this tithe and offering. Let your work be done, Lord. Thank you for this opportunity to share your word with the world, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Bless the giver, and we rebuke the spirit of poverty in the name of Jesus. And bless revivals here, church, and bring in souls. Lord, in the name of Jesus, amen.
Amen.
Lord, hallelujah. Praise the Lord. God's good, isn't he?
Amen.
Well, I think I don't have anything else to share.
I got a question.
Yeah.
We got email from one guy in India that said the people that he's trying to get the Bibles to don't read English. Is that the one that we get Bibles over there that's in their language?
Yeah, in India, all the Bibles that we send in India is in their language.
Okay, I just
our supplier
checking.
Is in their language. And they have at least, there's at least two languages, Hindi, and there's a language, and there's another one that I don't know how to, I can't pronounce it. At least two, there are two languages we've sent in. And the area that they live in has, each area has a different language. Most don't read English, but the Bible College in India does. That's why I wanted to send that. I don't know if we can get some stuff translated in the future, but our distributor in India has them in their languages. So.
Good. That's what I was just wondering about.
Yeah. And so I wanted to praise the Lord that we can do that.
Amen.
The last few times he gave them out to the youth. And, I had that picture printed out and I forgot to bring it. I don't know if I can pull it up on here or not.
That's one he gave you like
4 weeks
ago?
Well, it's another one's they sent me. We just sent some more. And I got the pictures this week. I don't know if you see. You made a new banner. I gotta pull this up first. You made a new banner for us. Now holding the banner up the back here. I don't know if you can turn. Let me see, 25 this time.
Hold it still, Neil.
I did print the pictures out, but they're at home. Maybe Lord translate the pictures over here for us.
Okay. That's good.
And
just direct, doing the Lord's work.
Yeah. You get it?
Yeah, that's good.
I think this is a previous or something the kids had given them out to and stuff. So
yeah, one of your books coming next, books of yours coming up, that'd be kind of neat to have that embedded in the book.
Yeah, I would. And
next book would be Reaching All Nations. There you go. Where's your next one?
Yeah.
Reaching All Nations.
Yeah. And I wanted to cover the basics in the first two, so that's what that was about. And so I'm excited about that, and we're reaching the world, and maybe even be able to start a new church in South Africa. Maybe. This one guy that we're sending them to, sending my book to, and maybe send some Bibles to him. Maybe, you never know, end up being a birth of a new church out of in South Africa. So God is good, isn't he?
Amen. And all the time.
I just remember, like, it on that a sermon, time it can get hard, but you just keep moving forward, and trust me, you get discouraged and stuff, but you just can't look at that. You just gotta keep moving forward. I know a lot of people watching overseas go through a lot of stuff, but you know.
Amen.
I got one email. I couldn't quite understand it, but somebody was coming against them, and with something to do with Hindu, the belief over there. I can't remember what it was, and it was kind of hard to understand. But people go through a hard time, and they go through that. They get attacked from witch doctors. I've got emails about that, whatever you call them, and stuff. And but here's the thing, though: they can't do nothing to you if you're born again. They might contrive, but they can't touch you. Trust me on that. They can't touch you.
Where they can, you know.
The devil can't do nothing like that. Hey, but he'll try, though. And the worst attacks that he'll go through is not people are trying to put curses on you because he can't touch you. Some people speaking words against you and coming against you. That's the worst attacks, because the devil uses pretty much against you. In my opinion, that's what David went through. His worst attacks was some of his kids and people coming against him. So just keep that in mind. You know, Jesus said they'd do it. So I don't have anything else, and it's been a good service, I think.
Amen.
And God's good, isn't he?
All the time.
Amen.
Praise you, Jesus.
Anybody else have anything, or? I don't know, I keep thinking, but guess. Oh, pray for this week, the 20th. Pray about that. You know what the 20th is, don't you?
Amen.
Pray for a peace, a protection over that. Over the inauguration, pray for peace.
Pray for God to heal our land.
Protection and God to heal our land. This to keep in mind, though, we got to look to God, not a man. We got to look to God. And we look to God, he'll bless us. Ain't that right?
Amen.
And we just keep that in mind. He's going to bless me regardless of who's the president. God's going to bless me. But I'd rather have somebody that's God-fearing.
They're trying to keep Franklin Graham from praying at the inauguration. So if he shows up, you know it's purely God-ordained.
Yeah.
Because he'll be there. They're trying everything in their power to keep him from doing the inaugural prayer.
We got to pray for Israel big time now.
Yeah.
With the UN passing that resolution, there could be war there any second.
Yeah, and there's a lot of turmoil, so we need to pray for against confusion. As the devil's rearing his head, some people are saying some things that it's demonic.
You ain't kidding there.
And,
it is.
That's the only way you can say it. It's demonic. Some of the stuff they're saying, I'm thinking they don't even know. They talk about killing people and stuff. And I mean people that are famous. You know, and that's no good. So pray that the Lord open their eyes. Because Jesus said, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. So pray that the Lord open their eyes and pray. Let's pray over that. And everybody, we agree in prayer for all of that. I know the Lord put it on my heart to and pray against the spirit of abortion.
Amen.
And that's not even a Christian issue. That's a human issue. You know what I mean? People look at it as a belief issue, but it's not a belief issue. It's a human issue.
Murder.
You know what I mean? That goes beyond.
Amen.
You know, that's... But pray about that, too. And Lord, I ask you to bless the inauguration. Let there be peace. And I pray for peace in this country, Lord. And
yes, Lord.
The division of stop, Lord, in the name of Jesus, and there be peace in the name of Jesus. I pray against confusion in the name of Jesus. I rebuke the spirit of confusion in the name of Jesus, and I rebuke the spirit of abortion in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, I rebuke the spirit of abortion off of this country and confusion in the name of Jesus. Lord, I ask you to touch us and touch us as a country, Lord, and guide us and direct us, Lord, and send prophets, Lord, in the name of Jesus, to guide our officials, Lord, in the name of Jesus, and touch them, Lord, and let there be peace in the festivities and things that happen on the 20th and the inauguration, and it'll be peace and it'll go. Good Lord, and I ask you, Lord, that your will be done, and shut the naysayers' mouth, Lord, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, and bless us, Lord, in the name of Jesus, and touch us in a powerful way, and let us prosper, Lord, because you said you'd be prosper and be in health just as our soul prospers. So, Lord, let our soul prosper, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord, and I speak health in this country in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, I speak mass healings in the name of Jesus. Lord, just bring it in this country, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Amen. I heard some testimony of some of the things that's happened in India. Just the Lord just showing up and it was just some things that, like Jules and a missionary that was talking about. He was talking about revival, and kids being taken up into heaven, getting gemstones daily. For over a year, orphans. The last time they went, there was this woman that was almost dead from AIDS that was healed. As another one, and another one with TB, who was sent home to die, got healed. Pastor going into demonic controlled areas and God moving powerfully, so that the Hindu intercessor got saved.
Glory.
And now prayer walks for Christ. who the Hindu intercessor got saved and now is a prayer, does prayer walks for Jesus.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
The whole village is coming to Christ.
Glory.
So we're having a part of that. And I think that the Lord has allowed me to go because I probably wouldn't come back. I don't want to stay. I told somebody if I went over, I'd probably be preaching to thousands. It kind of ruined me. I've heard a lot of people say that. They go over to places like that, are hungry for God, so they don't want to come back here and preach. So this is so easy.
We still got some work here to do.
Yeah. And we're having a part of that. And I got some Bibles here. If you want to take one to give out to somebody, invite them to church. So we get, I like giving out Bibles. And I used to give out cases and cases and cases of them. Give a case a week. I like it just randomly. Just I call it, I don't know, hit and run. Just hand them a Bible and run off. I'm done. That's what I do. If you don't like to talk to somebody, you don't have to. Just hand them a Bible and have a card in it, the church card. We got something, just put it in there and say, here, just run off. They ain't going to turn down a Bible, especially, you know, if it says Bible on it. And at the time, the ones I had said Holy Bible, so they're not going to throw it away. I've done that, trust me. And God is good. I think we can close now. And anybody else has a prayer request, let me know. But pray, Lord, you touch India in the name of Jesus. Lord, touch them in Africa, Lord, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Amen. I remember prophesying over that God would send prophets to the government officials. I think it's starting now.
Amen.
Need to pray for Norman Davis. He might go in this week and have his leg cut off.
Or oh, man.
His toes.
Pray that. Lord, you touch Norman Davis, Lord. We rebuke that off of his leg in the name of Jesus. We rebuke the spirit of infirmity and or whatever
yes,
it is. We rebuke
healing,
the demonic
Lord.
Infection and stuff in the name of Jesus off of his leg.
Rebuke
and we speak
of
healing in the name of Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
In the name of Jesus, sir. In the name of
be
Jesus.
Be healed amen. In Jesus' name.
Lord, hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, amen. A lot of those places that the Bible's breaking out, the kids have more success in giving out prophetic words and praying for people than adults do.
Amen. That's scriptural.
Yeah, Jesus said that too. He said, because the disciples wanted to stop the kids and he got upset about it. So that's just something to think about. And anybody else have anything or? Had a good time in the Lord and had my first baptism. And so y'all just remind, just to bring some extra clothes with you so you can help me out next time and be a little easier. But it was good though, I liked it. I didn't remember meaning it as a bad interruption, it was good. And that blessed me. And
he got blessed now that you see him smile all
yeah,
the time.
Yeah, he, the Lord's going to prosper him. I just seen blessing over him.
Amen.
That's what I saw. And so let's pray that Lord just give him blessings in the name of Jesus. Speak
yes,
blessing.
Thank
in
you,
the name
Jesus.
Of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you. God bless.